To get to their spawning grounds, salmon must travel extraordinary distances, overcoming some serious obstacles along the way. But just how hard is it to battle against a raging torrent?
Now, salmon make it look easy. The only way for me to fully understand what they go through is to experience it for myself. Oh!
First, I need to position myself at the bottom of these rapids.
Oh, guys, slippery!
Salmon migrate from as far away as Greenland to spawn in the upper reaches of the River Dee. The flow is overwhelming, and for the first time, I'm truly understanding just what these salmon have to do. Time of year, melting snow creates a barrier of freezing cold water within the river. For the cold-blooded salmon, these low temperatures prevent their muscles from working efficiently, so they pause their journey and wait for the water to warm up.
Now, salmon won't swim up a river if the temperature's below 5 degrees. Too cold for them. It's 2 degrees today. I'm an idiot. Oh, freezing. Oh, here you go.
The water is just so powerful. Even on rapids as small as these, I can barely move forward. How fish make this journey is mind-boggling.
It's just one tiny waterfall. It's 100 kilometres down to the sea that way. They've still got 25 more to go up in that direction. I know I'm not designed for it, but it is so hard to get up that. I'm not surprised that a salmon is just one solid block of muscle, because that's what it takes. I'm out of here, it's freezing. Oh. Still looking, I was genuinely astonished at just how powerful the water was there. I'm still looking for these things. Now, there are salmon, adult salmon, and they've been massing downriver ever since Christmas, coming from the sea, just waiting to come up the river. They won't be eating what I'm looking for here, but the young salmon, the salmon par, that were born here, that hatched out last year, they will be eating these things, as will the dippers. And what we'll do is, when you come back, I'll try and show you exactly what it is, the treasure that's under the water here. We'll see you a bit later.
Hats off to him. I mean, as you know, Chris, I've been chucking myself in at the deep end a bit recently.
Oh, have you?
But I certainly wouldn't be doing it in this weather outdoors. He's going to get hypothermia.
I know. He's roughy and tufty, isn't he? The water down here is flowing freely. The difference is that at the top of the mountains just up there, it's pretty inaccessible at the moment for the very simple reason that it's frozen. And, of course, this is a hostile environment, therefore, for much of the life. But there are some species that have overcome it, that have adapted to it, and one of them is the snow bunting. Now, it's a small bunting species, and we have the Icelandic subspecies of it here nesting in the UK. We only have about 50 pairs nesting, but in the autumn, the numbers swell with birds coming over from Iceland. The males have much thicker plumage than the females, and this means that they can stay further up the mountain. They'll have to come down to areas where the snow is wind-blown so that they can access the ground, like these birds are, because they're seed-eating birds in the winter, and they need to find those seeds. The young birds and the females will go as far away as the coast, but the males try to stick as close to their breeding territories, right at the top of the mountains, above 900 metres, as they possibly can, so that they can get back there in the spring, get onto those territories and ensure that they're in place when the season starts in May. Really tough little birds, and those males have got extra, you know, padding. And when you pick them out of a net, if you've caught them, you can feel the difference, apparently, between a male and a female just by how fluffy it is.
Yeah, it's amazing to see such a small bird survive so well on those peaks. And on those peaks, the whole time we've been here, there's been snow. Even yesterday, we had a little flurry while we were sitting here. In fact, it all looked very pretty, didn't it? But on the whole, it's been, as we know, a very mild and wet winter, and that's caused havoc for a lot of our wildlife, especially hibernating animals like hedgehogs. Now, the mild weather means they come out of hibernation early. The wet weather means that many of them have been flooded out. And rescue centres have recently been inundated. Now, traditionally, rescue centres will keep those hedgehogs in over the winter, release them in spring at the ideal weight of 500 grams. But is that, in fact, the best strategy? Well, some scientists have begun to question that.
RSPCA Mallee Dams in Sussex rescue around 130 hedgehogs every year. Most come from people's gardens and are underweight and often sick. It's generally thought that hedgehogs hibernate through the entire winter, so rescue centres normally release these animals in the spring after hibernation. But the staff at Mallee Dams noticed some strange behaviour. The hibernating hedgehogs in care were occasionally waking up during the winter and seemed to be getting distressed. So the RSPCA joined forces with the University of Brighton in a controversial new study to see if releasing them early before hibernation would be of benefit. To chart their progress, each animal is tagged with a GPS locator before release.
This is another male. He's part of a group of five males that we've had in. We think they're all part of the same family.
These five hedgehogs were rescued from a local garden after they were discovered coughing.
I see hedgehogs in my garden all the time. And these ones I saw sort of mid-October to the end of October. Each one sort of every other night, basically. I'd be sitting in the kitchen looking out and there's a tiny hedgehog on the path. So I'd scoop it up, weigh it, realise it was, you know, quite small, and yeah, so I've kept them all in.
Back in December, after 2 weeks of treatment and being bulked up to a healthy weight, the boys were ready to be released back into the same garden, with the hope that they will settle into hibernation as quickly as possible.
Some people may go against what we're doing, but it's all about the welfare of the animal. They are wild animals, so it's good for them to be in their natural environment. They go into hibernation, the males generally come out before the females, ready to breed. If you interrupt that by keeping them in all winter, that's interfering with their natural behaviour and preventing them from being wild animals.
As night falls, Kate gives the tags one final inspection.
So how long will that stay on for? Hopefully for the winter, and then because we'll be monitoring where they are all winter and when they come out of hibernation, then I'll monitor them for about a week after they've come out, and then we'll probably take them off. The first time that I talked to them, I just felt really excited, because it's one thing knowing that you've got these animals on your doorstep. It's quite another thing to be able to help with a really important project that will hopefully help conserve them in future.
Harry, Herb, Hazel, Holly and Hebe now have to find themselves a safe place to hibernate and see out the winter. Hopefully this scheme will give our five hedgehogs a stress-free hibernation and the best chance for survival, whatever our winter throws at them.
Go on. Can't believe it's going.
And tomorrow I'll be tracking those hedgehogs and seeing how they're getting on in their hibernation, and in fact if that new strategy is working.
Excellent. Of course, hedgehogs are one of only three groups of British mammal that actually properly hibernate. I say groups because we have to collect all of the bats together. They do hibernate completely. So do dormice and the hedgehogs. But most of the other small mammals, therefore, remain active through the winter, as we know because we've been watching a wood mouse and some voles in our rodentorium. Now, Ben, one of our team, stays up all night watching this rodentorium, and this particular wood mouse had been visiting 80, 60, and last night 40 times. Here comes a little vole. He's not alone in there. But what we've been seeing is the mouse, well, basically pulling our rodentorium apart. He took some of the material from the roof and the sides and then used it to cover his food. Now, there was some initial thought that he was building a nest, but I didn't subscribe to that. The chamber's too big. It would be like pitching a tent in the Albert Hall, you know, and trying to insulate it. It just wouldn't work. I think what's happening there is that that little mouse is trying to cache his own food underneath there and hide it from any others that were coming in. And given that he went back to find some at the last shot you saw there, that might be right.
He's a busy little mouse. He's like a little Yorkshire Terrier, isn't he? He's in, he's out.
I can't stop moving.
He can't stop moving.
And, you know, and people are saying we should take that mouse with us all the way to Springwatch, but rest assured we won't. We'll leave him here in his natural environment and we'll leave him a good supply of food with it.